Hello, and welcome to this RSA Conference virtual session on Predicting Disruptive Technologies. I am your host, Brenna Dobbins of RSA Conference. During the session, all participants will be in listen-only mode. At the close of the presentation, our speakers will be conducting a question and answer session. Throughout the presentation, if you do have a question, please use the chat feature which is located in the lower left corner of your screen. As a reminder, this session is being recorded. Following the session, you will receive a follow-up email containing a link to the video replay. The replay will also be posted to rsaconference.com. Lastly, ISACA is offering one CPE credit for members that attend this virtual session. Attendees will need to self-report on the ISACA website by logging into their account. I would now like to turn it over to Rosemary Amato to begin the session.
Thank you very much, Brenna. Everyone, welcome to this RSA conference webcast in conjunction with ISACA. We will be sharing insights on predicting disruptive technologies with you today. As you are probably aware, RSA Conference conducts information security events around the globe that connect you to industry leaders who share their personal insights. RSA's mission is to bring together the best and brightest in cybersecurity to highlight the industry's most critical issue. As I hope you also know, ISACA is an independent, nonprofit, global association engaging in the development, adoption, and use of globally accepted industry-leading knowledge and practices for information systems. Today, RSA is very happy to have with us five ISACA expert speakers who are connected with ISACA's SheLeadsTech program. They will provide their personal insights on the most disruptive technologies that will lead to digital transformation in the next 3 to 5 years. We will look at the potential security issues for these technologies and provide insights on what you can do to help your enterprise manage change. Please remember that these presentations are vendor agnostic. The speakers may reference different methods, tools, articles, solutions, and/or frameworks, but the opinions are their own and do not represent any attempt to sell services to the webcast listeners. You will be able to ask questions during the presentation using the chat, but the questions will be answered at the end of the fifth presentation. But please don't hesitate to start sending them through or writing them down and be prepared to ask it at the allotted time. Ready to get started? I know I am. So let me start with my introduction. I am Rosemary Amato, a managing director within global finance at Deloitte, based in Amsterdam, the Netherlands, and serving as the EMEA controller. In the 20-plus years I have been in the workforce, I have seen the coming of age of many disruptive technologies, and looking back now, the impact those technologies have had on our work environment is absolutely amazing. Do you remember the first ATM card, or the first smart mobile phone, or even the advent of internet banking? What about all the medical technology changes? If you had cataract surgery just 20 years ago, you would have been put in a bed with sandbags on the side of your head and had to stay there for a few days. When I had a detached retina 8 years ago, it was literally handled in 15 minutes, and I was out of the hospital the same day. Disruptive technologies have had an impact in almost every business over the years, and they will continue to have an impact. Companies are spending more and more on innovation-related disruptive solutions. In M&A deals alone, 2016 saw an investment four times the $72 billion that was spent just 4 years earlier in 2012. We are seeing political and economic shifts impacting disruptive technologies, attitudes in how social media is used and perceived, and I'm sure you all saw the latest news this last week on what's happening in that arena, unpredictable weather patterns, constant threats of terrorism. We recently saw the alleged poisoning in the UK, and then all the variety of cyber attacks. These are just few of the issues hitting the world today. From a business perspective, all size companies are being exposed to failure, exploitation, theft, fraud, and abuse. And the only thing we can say is that uncertainty is the new normal. So how do we keep up with each of these distinct disruptive technologies? Blockchain, cognitive, digital reality. If you're not exploring it, your customers and or your stockholders are asking why. But if you are doing things in these arenas, they may be asking why you are spending so much money. You just can't win, can you? I believe that all the new disruptive technological forces need to be considered not as individual solutions, but complementary solutions, and they must work in harmony. For this to work, you need to look at approaching change more broadly. The pace of change is accelerating as new technologies displace established ones. Entire industries are being shaken up. We have a drugstore chain purchasing a pharma company. We have an automobile manufacturer trying to go into space. We must use these disruptive technologies to complement each other and drive greater value. Blockchain, for example, can serve as a new foundational protocol for trust throughout the enterprise and beyond. By using cognitive technologies, automated responses can be possible across all enterprise domains. Geographic barriers can be broken down between people with digital reality. And yes, work is being reshaped, and who knows what new products will come into existence in the next month, the next year, or the next 5 years. So today, we are going to be hearing about four specific areas. We'll look at cybersecurity in healthcare, which will be focused on medical devices, smart hospitals, sensitive data. That will be then followed by artificial intelligence and financial services, connecting to big data and bots. Then RPA, robotic process automation. And we will end up with a look at the future of the cloud. So I'm ready to hear from our first speaker. I hope you are too. So introducing Justine Bone, the CEO of MedSec. Let me hand over to you, Justine.
Thank you very much, Rosemary, for that introduction. And thank you to ISACA for having me participate on this webinar. I am thrilled and honored to be continuing to work with ISACA in various ways, and I'm very much honored to be a part of the SheLeadsTech platform. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to share things from my perspective. As Rosemary mentioned, I am the CEO of MedSec. We are a cybersecurity company that focuses on healthcare based out of Miami, Florida. I've been with MedSec for a number of years now, and one of our major areas of focus is medical devices and the security implications of medical devices as we start to see their increased adoption throughout healthcare systems. My background is really related to evaluating the risks associated with emerging and disruptive technologies. My origins are in vulnerability research, how systems break, what sort of techniques attackers and hackers use to break into systems, and what attackers can do once systems of various kinds are compromised. And, you know, over the years, I've really applied this in various ways, this perspective, whether I was the CISO, head of security at Bloomberg for a while. I put together a security program there that really emulated what bad guys might do if they were focusing on Bloomberg technology. I've been developing startups such as MedSec for a number of years, or even evaluating peer research as it relates to cybersecurity, such as the work that I do with large industry conferences where I evaluate submissions. Everything I do has really been through the lens of the attacker. Can an attacker break this technology? And if they can, how does that work, and what can they do with that? And things have evolved over the last 20 or so years that I've been working in information security. You know, back in the day when I was really hands-on myself, was very focused on the application layer, on software vulnerabilities. And, you know, the technology giants have really shored things up over the last few years to the point where, you know, attackers really have to work very hard to compromise, whether it's devices such as smartphones or desktop systems. You know, things have gotten harder and harder, and so attackers now have been developing, you know, more and more sophisticated techniques to compromise systems, and now we're seeing a lot of focus all the way down to the hardware layer. That said, manufacturers, device manufacturers are sitting up and paying attention, and, you know, the sort of arms race continues, and we see now with, you know, the adoption and the spread of, for example, disruptive technologies such as the Internet of Things, a much wider attack surface, if you will. I mean, the IoT, Internet of Things, if you think about it, well, you know, how did this come about? Well, I like to think about the sort of underlying fundamentals to the Internet of Things. You know, how did this happen? We've got this technology miniaturization, if you will, where embedded systems are getting smaller and smaller. The compute power, the battery power on these embedded systems is getting more and more sophisticated. So now everything is becoming connected. And as we do this, you know, some manufacturers are really paying attention to this and others not so much. So we've got a lot of connected devices that perhaps are not being maintained. They're running out-of-date software. They're being run via default credentials, default passwords. And then we see, you know, the spread of malware and botnets taking advantage of this. So what I do is I look at a subset of this, really, which is as it relates to healthcare, medical devices. And myself and my team have noticed a few sort of common themes across the healthcare space. There are 5,500 hospitals just in the United States alone, and every one of these hospitals is in a different position when it comes to cybersecurity. Each has its own approach to cybersecurity, and you know, there's a lot of variety out there when it comes to hospital networks and needs and capabilities. And unfortunately, some of these hospitals are not yet able to support industry best practices. So when you think about the manufacturers who are developing products for these hospital environments, in some cases, these manufacturers are really forced to almost build in insecure capabilities, such as default passwords. These manufacturers are forced to support just a whole plethora of configuration options, which leads to really complex environments, and with complexity comes insecurity. So what we see is a need for hospitals to really start introducing standards and unifying around standards when it comes to cybersecurity requirements. And these hospitals, you know, they have their work cut out for them. I think the Mayo Clinic has talked publicly about the number of medical devices they have to manage, something like 25,000 networked medical devices alone just within the Mayo Clinic. And, it, you know, if you can think about the challenge related to managing this exposure, if we forced these hospitals to comply with industry best practices as it relates to passwords, for example, we would have all of these healthcare workers needing to memorize, you know, dozens of unique, long, complex passwords, you know, that are supposed to be changed every 30 days. And this is just not a realistic requirement for, you know, a high-stake environment such as a hospital. So what we need are solutions around usability that also address security requirements. And, you know, when we think about passwords as a form of authentication, it's really just not a scalable solution anymore. So one thing that one space that I've worked in is biometrics, and I think there's a lot of opportunity related to biometrics within healthcare to enable us to continue to connect these sophisticated healthcare delivery devices, but in a secure way so that we're not exposing high-stakes environments. Another really quite fundamental challenge for hospitals is asset management. I mean, what is connected to my network right now? And these devices, to a certain extent, have been built on proprietary technologies, proprietary custom network protocols, for example. So traditional cybersecurity solutions such as vulnerability scanners, for example, that are common practice within other verticals such as finance, these solutions, these security solutions, just don't work inside these highly customized environments such as hospitals. So what we need is the emergence of more custom security solutions that address the specific protocols that these medical devices speak. And, of course, you know, maintaining these devices is another challenge for hospitals. We need new solutions around update management, patch management. We need a universal way for these patches to be distributed and applied. So, you know, whilst we've made significant progress in the last few years, what we really see is a drive for manufacturers, all the stakeholders to come together as it relates to the Internet of Things, as it relates to healthcare. We need manufacturers to come together with their clients, the hospitals, to standardize, if you will, and move away from this sort of highly proprietary background that folks have come from. So, to close out from my perspective, I think in terms of disruption, you know, we need advances in technology capabilities such as authentication, such as update management. We need security to be usable. We need security to be reliable and almost seamless, especially in a high-stake environment such as a hospital. And we also need advances in terms of collaboration, not just within healthcare between manufacturers and hospitals, but within wider industry as well. So I think I'll pass back to you, Rosemary, and I look forward to addressing any questions later in the session.
Thank you, Justine, and I definitely could relate to the comments you made about how do you have all these passwords with all these equipment, and it definitely is not scalable. So I'm sure we'll have some questions regarding what are you going to do for security solutions for the Internet of Things. But let's move on to Ashley Holmes now. Ashley is a Vice President, Information Security Governance Manager at SunTrust Bank. And she'll be talking to us about artificial intelligence and financial services. Ashley, over to you.
Thank you, Rosemary. I just wanted to thank ISACA and RSA for allowing us to have this webcast and also support the SheLeads program that's associated with ISACA. So again, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you all today. I know we have detailed bios on the webcast registration page. However, just a little bit about my background and career. My career primarily stems from consulting with a public accounting firm where I focused on IT audit and security advisory engagements. some special information security projects such as gap analyses and system implementation reviews across a myriad of industries. I also specifically focused on regulatory items such as Sarbanes-Oxley, FSMA, CMS, PCI, HIPAA, SFIEC, HITRUST, and lastly, service organization control reporting, which I'm sure most people are familiar with those items. The previous few years of my career have been spent with SunTrust Bank, which is where I'm at today. I focused on managing team efforts regarding information security assessments of third parties, our information security issues management, managing our digital client-facing risk assessment program. So think of our the SunTrust digital footprint, and also managing InfoSec KRI and KPIs associated with that program and executive-level reporting. My portion of the presentation, as Rosemary stated previously, is related to bots and artificial intelligence and how these technologies are impacting the financial services industry. So I'd like to jump right in, I guess, kind of with an overview of those particular technologies and then how those technologies are being used today in financial services. So a lot of times people hear artificial intelligence and bots or robotics, and they think they're one and the same. And that's not necessarily true. Not all bots require artificial intelligence, and not all artificial intelligence software are implemented in robots or bots. Artificial intelligence is essentially any software or device which perceives its surrounding environment and takes actions to maximize its chance of achieving its intended tasks or goals, or more simply said, software that mimics human cognitive functions. Artificial intelligence by itself essentially covers several, or I guess a lot of big data fields, which aren't always connected to robots. An example of that is like predicting stock markets or a customer's credit worthiness. In regards to bots, essentially, this is the actual physical hardware that performs a physical task using pre-programmed logic, or if artificial intelligence software is embodied in that mechanical system. Financial institutions have been using artificial intelligence for quite some time to aid in back office operations, assessing customers' credit worthiness, or another way of saying, and also enhancing the client interaction. Also, we see it used with online trading, especially for our investment banking arm pieces of a financial institution. Also, more commonly, managing fraud and financial crimes by monitoring behavioral patterns of users for any transaction anomalies. A lot of times, those are those use like artificial intelligence risk engines. And then also in the real estate arm of a financial institution, you know, in managing properties. For instance, AI has been around at least for a few decades. And notably, like in 2001, which was almost 17 years ago, there was a simulated, I guess you can call it a battle, between robots and humans, and they were seeing who could actually outdo the other by trading, and they specifically picked pork belly and gold trading. So I don't want to go into more into that, but just to give you an idea that since 2001, robots have been tested performing human type of cognitive functions associated with financial trading. If you want to learn more about that, you can just simply Google robots beat humans in a trading battle. It's from the BBC. I think IBM had something to do with that, but that study anyways. But in the most recent years, artificial intelligence companies, or I guess other people can refer to them as well as fintech companies, they've received double the amount of funding in the previous 2 years than they have in the last couple of decades. A lot of emphasis is coming into a term that you may have heard called open banking, and I'll talk some more about that towards the end. But several financial institutions, especially the top 10 banks, they're investing in fintech providers to supply the machine learning devices and capabilities to gain that extra competitive edge that they need to enhance the client experience and engage their customers in ways that they haven't been able to. And so all of this to say is big data is needed to feed these types of systems and this software for artificial intelligence and robots. So they kind of go, big data goes hand in hand with these two specific technologies. I know most financial institutions, when you read articles maybe in Forbes or somewhere else where we get your business news, over half of the major financial institution players are expected to make substantial investments in artificial intelligence and robotics within the next 3 years. So it'll be very interesting to see what these fintech companies come up with, whether that's open APIs to support the open banking, I guess, scenario that a lot of financial institutions are striving towards. And then going back to bots or robotics, I remember in college I had to debate whether moving operations offshore, you know, was a good idea or not. And while I was preparing for this presentation, it made me think, wow, offshoring was a new idea when I was in college. And it obviously had a lot of negative notions associated with it, such as loss of jobs and, we'll enhance our cost savings and we'll also gain these significant operational efficiencies. But now thinking with bots and artificial intelligence, the idea of moving operations offshore almost appears to be obsolete due to the ability to attain the similar or more cost savings using artificial intelligence and/or robotics. So like I said, artificial intelligence has been around for a few decades. However, bots are the newer, buzzword these days in regards to being used in the daily workforce. So I mentioned how bots and AI are used currently in financial services today, and artificial intelligence is used for a myriad of processes and operations, including automating investing advice or automating tax planning or thwarting financial crime. There's also several artificial intelligence software that can automate the underwriting tools for mortgage or credit or insurance arms. AI-driven chatbot through a financial institution's web domain is another example. I did read maybe a few months ago about an experiment that JPMorgan Chase had completed, where they had a manual review of 12,000 annual commercial credit agreements from their legal arm, which they said required 360,000 hours, like man hours. And the artificial intelligence solution that they were piloting completed that task in seconds. So we're also seeing this from a legal perspective as well within a financial institution. FIs are also using AI on the front end to secure customer identities and mimic bank employees in hopes of deepening that digital interaction with their clients or their customers, and ultimately in hopes of engaging those customers across all of their digital channels and being able to offer more comprehensive products and services in a, I guess, more expedient manner would be the best way to say that. Financial institutions are using bots more so from the aspect of taking complex processes and shrinking them to a task which can be completed in minutes or in some case seconds, like I mentioned with the J.P. Morgan Chase study. For example, there's a few financial organizations that have implemented bots to aid with company access requests. And you have to think, banks have lots of legacy systems that they can't necessarily unplug and throw away because they're so intertwined even into their newer technologies. And it's quite convoluted, and I'm sure there's more to it than that, but simply stated. But where a task that would require an employee to search and or use several of those legacy systems just to compile the information needed to complete that access request would normally probably take 13 to 15 minutes, but where they've done the testing with the bots, it can complete that task, that one access request, in 1.5 minutes. So it's pretty astounding what the significant operational efficiency that financial institutions are seeing with bots. And that was just one example. Another example is associated with mortgages. For instance, today, mortgage processors who visit the FEMA website to see if a property is in a FEMA disaster zone, with bots, the bot will automatically pull the property information from the FEMA website, download evidence, and then upload it to the respective repository, and then note that that mortgage in the mortgage origination system that the task has been complete. That's the same scenario. It took about 10 to 12 minutes for one mortgage processor, and then it only took about a minute to a minute and a half for the bot. So there's a lot of testing. There's a lot of experimenting.
And Ashley, I think we can probably be talking about bots and all the different things happening because there is so much happening in this area, but we need to move on to our next presenter. So those
sure.
that have questions for Ashley, please start sending them through, and hopefully she'll be able to address it at the end of the call. So thank you very much, Ashley. Let's now move to Natasha Barnes. Natasha is an IT manager working in the internal audit and financial advisory team at Protiviti, and she's going to be giving us an overview of robotic process automation. Natasha, it's all yours.
Great. Thank you, Rosemary. Also want to extend my gratitude to ISACA and RSA, and also proud to be part of SheLeadsTech. So throughout my career, I've supported information assurance consulting and auditing engagements. Over the years, certain questions are continuously asked. Can we do this faster? Can this be more effective? Can we rely on this data or process? Today I'm excited to discuss robotic process automation capabilities to demonstrate how they can address these questions and add a tremendous amount of value. Robotic process automation, or RPA tools, are among the suite of digital technologies being considered to improve efficiencies, effectiveness, and risk mitigation capabilities for business operations. RPA is the use of automation software to perform manual, repeatable processes to save time, money, and increase reliability. RPA is not referring to getting your own personal C-3PO, R2-D2, BB-8, or any other entertaining robot sidekicks. However, it does offer a virtual workforce that can still provide significant benefits. As the automation software learning curve is relatively shallow, RPA considerations are happening across functional areas, such as operations, finance, HR, audit, and risk management. A background or fundamental experience with programming can be helpful, but with training on the software selected, the idea is that users across functional areas could ramp up within a relatively short amount of time to begin reaping benefits from these tools. Examples of automation opportunities include user access provisioning and deprovisioning, contract compliance and SLA monitoring, invoice processing and accounts payable, and audit activities, such as automating test routines and conducting continuous monitoring. To better understand RPA capabilities, let's explore some common business problems. One, the evolving complexity in business processes. A single business process can involve multiple applications and outputs. This can raise concerns about ensuring that all steps within a process are performed accurately, completely, and consistently. With RPA, all essential steps can be configured to achieve high-quality goals. RPA bots can navigate across multiple systems to perform activities and data analysis. 2, insufficient staffing needs. Just as Ashley was alluding to earlier, common methods of addressing this challenge include partnering with contractors and offshore personnel. Manual, repeatable activities can be shifted to RPA bots instead. This would allow personnel to focus on other high-value added assignments in addition to providing bot oversight. And 3, compliance activities. Across industries, compliance efforts are significant undertakings to mitigate risks and consequences. RPA can execute compliance processes and conduct corresponding audit activities. Additional RPA benefit highlights include reductions in human error, an audit trail of bot activities, and the development of scalable processes. I invite you to take a moment to think of RPA candidates within your organization. There are essentially endless opportunities to consider. Gartner forecasts the robotic process automation software market will grow by 41% year over year to 2020. Recently, a major automation software vendor received a significant amount of private funding. This not only bodes well for the vendor, of course, but for the automation software market overall. It demonstrates active pursuits in capitalizing on automation software advantages. Almost every organization is doing some form of proof of concept of RPA, and many have moved well beyond pilot stages to start seeing an impactful return on investment. Per the graphic, the RPA lifecycle starts with identifying an automation opportunity and is an iterative process. It sits on a two-tier foundation of standard business and technology elements. While automation software can be installed on a user's PC or virtual machine, typically organizations establish a centralized function to provide oversight of RPA activities and minimize shadow IT expansion. Otherwise, RPA requires minimal involvement from IT teams. Automation software features a control center that centralizes bot development and governance through a center of excellence. This provides visibility and efficient management of the bot inventory. RPA simulates human interaction, hence usage of the software does not adversely impact the IT environment. The existing interfaces of applications are accessed by RPA bots. Now let's move on to a use case for RPA. This slide shows a comparison of a user provisioning process performed manually and via RPA. In the manual approach, a user's information is obtained from the HR system, and then the user is added to the financial system. There are two routes depending on whether the user account already existed in the financial system. If it already existed, then about 5% of time is allocated to troubleshooting. Otherwise, the new account is created within the financial system. In the robotics approach, all of the steps in the manual process have been automated. This contributes to the RPA potential of greater than 90%. The 5% previously allocated to troubleshooting will now result in a list of exceptions that can be reviewed later on. As RPA can conduct activities extremely efficiently, in seconds, as Ashley was mentioning earlier, you can imagine how much time could be saved with this type of process in your organization. With any new tool, there are always risks to consider and adoption challenges. Standard access management controls apply to RPA bot programming and are of paramount importance considering increased reliance. If the RPA configured processes are inaccurate or if the data quality is poor, then process reliability will be diminished. RPA bots are not set it and forget it tools. They require monitoring and periodic reviews to retain their utility. Some quick adoption guidance. Find an automation opportunity that has established processes. Research software options and applicable use cases, and develop a proof of concept to make a compelling business case. Automation software is already making significant impacts and is forecasted to continue doing so. Now there are new questions to consider. How will this change staffing considerations? How fast can we evaluate it to start realizing its benefits? I hope that everyone is now equipped with a new pair of RPA lenses to review your daily activities and identify RPA candidates. Let the automation transformations begin. Back to you, Rosemary.
Thank you so much, Natasha. This is definitely a very interesting topic, and I'm seeing some questions coming in, and we'll be addressing those shortly. But now for our last speaker, Claudia Johnson. She's a cloud technologist at Oracle, and she's going to present her views of the future of the cloud. Over to you, Claudia.
Thanks, Rosemary. I'm very honored and humbled to be part of this SheLeadsTech program today, and I thank ISACA for organizing this. So as far as future of cloud is concerned, I think we need to look at it from, differentiated a little bit. We've got infrastructure as a service, like compute and storage. We've got platform as a service, enabling cloud customers to have a certain level of programmability. We've got software as a service. So depending on which one of these, I think the future might look a little bit different. Infrastructure as a service, I personally see as, short to medium term increasing in terms of, penetrability. But in long term, maybe it's going to taper off. And I'll talk a little bit about why I think that in a minute. Platform as a service, I think, is going to take off as well as software as a service, not only medium, but also long-term. So I think one of the key points in here to understand where the future cloud is going is something that's seen both as an obstacle as well as an enabler, namely security, which ties us all back into very clearly back to ISACA, considering that security and compliance is one of the key points there. And I'd like to reference a particular event that occurred nearly a year ago now. It took place over several months in 2017, namely the Equifax breach. So for me, that's one of the major breaches of this decade, not only in terms of, how it impacted the company that Equifax itself, but also the impact it's had on, identity theft in terms of, the fact that personal information was leaked, including social security numbers, which is part of, an American citizen's identity, both for opening a new bank account or in terms of registering to vote. There's been a number of blogs about this breach, which didn't just happen in one single instance. There were numerous things that went wrong. But one of the things that happened was that instance in the infrastructure as a service on Amazon, definitely no criticism of Amazon here, was not patched. So, this is the sad and boring truth of security in 2018, is it's still one of the probably single largest source of why security breaches happen is because patches aren't taking place timely. I know Justine mentioned that in her presentation as well. So what happened here was the company Equifax is using infrastructure as a service, meaning they have their own software in the cloud. They are responsible for patching. I think it was something like a five-month lapse between the patch, when the patch was available, and when the breach took place. And it's a tough job. Every organization that I speak to and that I read about, and I try to follow as many current breaches as I possibly can. It's tough keeping up with patch management. It's a really challenging task, especially if the organization in question does not have that as their key core competency. They're busy trying to bring up new IT projects, busy trying to keep up with IT requirements, compliance requirements, and sometimes the patch management doesn't always take place as fast as it should. And here's where software as a service, or let's say cloud applications, come into play. Because for software as a service, which is one of the areas where Oracle, the company I'm working for, is working on everything from human capital management to enterprise resource planning, there's a lot of different cloud applications out there in 2018. Here, the responsibility for patching is with the cloud provider. So basically, organizations opting for software as a service are outsourcing their patching responsibilities to the cloud provider, which has a definitely very clear attractiveness in terms of security. You know, we're still seeing a lot of organizations skeptical of cloud for security reasons, particularly in Germany where I'm located, also because of compliance reasons, things like GDPR. But I think going forward, this is actually going to be a key differentiator for cloud providers, is when they are upfront about the kind of security they provide, how they provide it, where they stand as far as compliance is concerned. And, you know, if you look at something like the European Union and ISA, they did a study a while ago comparing cloud security versus on-premise security and came up with a very interesting result, namely that, you know, money spent on security is better invested in cloud security than it is in on-premise security for the very simple, you know, cloud, let's say, premise that you're sharing the cost between many, many customers, between many, many organizations. That's a very interesting study by Anisa. Happy to provide the link if anybody's interested later on. But if we you know, look at this overall, I think cloud is here to stay. Infrastructure as a service is very attractive as the first step because it means you can, you know, have your own software, your own applications, but you still put it up in the cloud. However, for security and compliance reasons, I think software as a service is long-term going to pull ahead faster. What does that mean for security? I think security for organizations moving to cloud will change from how do I protect my infrastructure, how do I protect my systems, and obviously how do I protect my users. But if you're moving to cloud, it's going to be much, much stronger on how do I protect my users from getting exploited. So it's going to change from, you know, the network firewall intrusion detection type of security systems to identity and access management, maybe even moving on to things like cloud access security broker. How do I protect my users when they're using a software as a service application from their credentials being stolen? Things like two-factor authentication will be very, very important going forward and single sign-on. So that's basically, you know, how I see cloud. And I think things like GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation here in Europe, very, very big topic. I think that's something that people need to be looking at when they're looking at cloud providers as well, because that's that whole compliance topic is going to be very challenging, particularly if organizations have, you know, sometimes you hear about 90 different cloud providers. So that might be something where you look to consolidate the cloud providers you're working with. So that kind of summarizes what I want to talk about today. Thank you very much, and I'd like to hand back to Rosemary.
Well, thank you, Claudia. And I know we are going to have some cloud questions for sure for you shortly. But we have about 10 minutes left. So this is the best part of the webcast, and that is answering the questions from our audience. So we're going to kick off with a first question, and this will go to Natasha. Natasha, as you know, the audit function has historically been slow to adopt the emerging trends that you talked about. Do you think auditors are now mentally ready to replace the old ways of working with RPAs? Or is culture going to hinder the adoption of this technology?
Great. Thanks, Rosemary. Yes, I do think that auditors will be ready. I know especially some of the teams I've been on, once you've done a good amount of manual testing, you get to a point where you have just come to the brink and would love for there to be another option. So I think that they are ready to be able to embrace this type of change. Of course, all change is challenging, but the benefits are worth it. And I think that in order to go about making this type of cultural transformation, we can start with having proof of concepts, trying to really make a compelling business case to try and see how it could change just one process. You know, if it can just change or save time in terminated user testing, then that would be enough, hopefully, to get the ball rolling. So hopefully taking it a little at a time, developing the proof of concept, and sharing it will help. Thank you.
Thank you. This next question is for Justine. Justine, during your presentation, you talked about the challenge of all these individual passwords that all of us have to remember. And if you start looking at having passwords for IoT devices, wow, I just can't imagine. I have enough as it is already. Any ideas on what could be done for IoT devices to secure them? What are you seeing in the healthcare field?
Thank you, Rosemary. Yes, yeah, you're right. Passwords have been sort of embraced as a one-size-fits-all authentication solution. But when you think about it, we're not always authenticating humans. In some cases, we're authenticating devices. And so there are different techniques for authenticating devices versus human users of devices that can be applied. So the good news is there are solutions that we know work. And that can be anything from what I mentioned previously with biometrics. You know, we're seeing end users becoming increasingly comfortable using biometric-based authentication systems all the way up to our smartphones today with facial recognition and fingerprint recognition. And then we've got encryption solutions, public key encryption systems, public key infrastructure. These are certificates, files, if you like, that can be placed on devices to authenticate the identity of devices. And then we've got what was previously mentioned, two-factor authentication or multi-factor authentication solutions. So there are definitely alternatives to passwords. We just have this problem where we've got a lot of legacy systems out there that have only been built to embrace the use of passwords. So as we see technology starting to evolve and roll over, we'll see the more widespread use of alternatives.
Thank you. This next question is for Ashley. We've seen, so many of the banks on their internet websites. They have chatbots now, and most of the time it starts from the AI processor, and eventually you may end up talking to a real live person. But if you look at how AI may continue, especially in the financial services industry, and then you link that into blockchain, do you think AI combined with blockchain will really change what a bank does? And may it actually impact banks disappearing? I'll be a little provocative with this question. What do you think, Ashley?
So I think it's undeniable that artificial intelligence and blockchain technologies are two of the, primary technologies that are catalyzing the pace of innovation and, causing the financial industry to pivot and pivot significantly. I think it depends on the degree of technical complexity with what we're trying to do, and I agree, almost every website that you go to has a chat bot feature, which most people don't realize are bots. But also, if you come, going to your question of intersecting artificial intelligence and blockchain technologies, will that ultimately lead to brick-and-mortar banks being eliminated? I think a lot of folks would like to see that happen. I think where there's a lack of technology that's available today from a trusted source is there are a few things that you just can't do without being face-to-face today at a bank. For instance, when you go into a bank and you're speaking with a teller, and you have an issue with, I'm trying to think of a good example for you, but essentially there's a couple of things that clients can only do when they're face-to-face with a bank representative. And I think what we're waiting on is somebody to develop that technology that encompasses the AI features with blockchain to ultimately get to that path. But I think today, if you want to know within 3 to 5 years, are brick and mortar banks going to be gone because of those two technologies? I would say probably not. Maybe if you're looking at a larger roadmap, maybe like 10, 15, 20 years, I think that's when that would be more feasible. I just don't, from what I've seen today, I do not believe that that technology exists today to take brick and mortar banks out of the way. But at the same time, I think it's really catchy. I mean, I obviously don't work for Amazon or Google or Facebook, but, you know, Amazon and Google have also shown a lot of interest in pushing to become banks themselves and offering their own checking accounts and things like that to their customer bases. And so they're constantly pushing and bucking the trend that banks should be non-existent and that they could just as easily be, you know, a clearinghouse themselves without the traditional regulatory and compliance that comes with the brick and mortar and traditional banks. So keep an eye out on those companies and see what's going on with them. And I think that'll be pretty indicative of what those technologies can do in the next 10 years or so.
Thank you much, and we'll see how your predictions come true in the next 3 to 5 years. Another question here. This one we're giving to Claudia. Claudia, we know that a lot of companies did not go to the cloud originally because of their initial security fears. Do you think security fears are now waning and more people will be adopting cloud in the future?
Yes and no. So I think I don't think security fears are waning, whether they be for cloud or on-premise. What I think is happening is people are realizing that even on-premise, no matter how much money they spend on security, it's just increasing from year to year. The risk is increasing. The amount of money they need to spend to secure their infrastructure is increasing. And cloud is being seen as an alternative to have a certain level of security without the same amount of risk and cost. So I don't think the fear is waning. The reality is, security is and will remain to be a very big concern going forward. And then on the other hand, I think the overall cloud offering is the key thing here, that you're sharing the cost with many different organizations. Does that answer your question?
I think it does, Claudia. This next question is for all the presenters. We just want a one word, or maybe it's a two-word answer. And which one of the current disruptive technologies that we talked about today will have the biggest impact on business in 2018? Let's start with Natasha. Which one do you think?
Automation.
Okay, Ashley.
She stole my word, automation.
Oh, but that you could say the same word.
we go to
Justine.
Well, I won't say automation, so I'll leave it at authentication.
Authentication. Okay, Claudia.
In German they say Claudia, and therefore I'm going to say cloud.
Ah, perfect. And I'll give you my perspective. I'm going with automation. Excuse me, automation also. So we're right almost at the top of the hour. I want to thank our speakers from ISACA's SheLeadsTech program. And we have the link on the site now that you can learn more about SheLeadsTech at SheLeadsTech.ISACA.org. And I'm going to pass it back to Brenna to close.
Thank you so much, and thank you to all of our speakers for this excellent presentation, and thank you all for joining us for this RSA Conference virtual session. We hope you will join us in San Francisco from April 16th to 20th for RSA Conference 2018. For more information and to register, please visit rsaconference.com. Thank you. You may now disconnect.